I think we can never forget that what we're talking about is the well-being and the future of not only our farm, not only the farms of our neighbors, but our communities as a whole. Goals are based on values, they're based on moral positions, on visions of what the future can be, and that's where we've got to start. Let's be clear about who's fighting for what in this farm policy debate. What we're fighting for is not only the preservation of family farming, but the increase in the number of small, commercial, viable family-sized farms. The alternative is an increased concentration, centralization of agricultural production in fewer hands, larger and larger operations. What we're fighting for is decentralized family farms, thousands of them, more of them, as the primary producers of food in this country.
We bought our farm, we signed a 30-year mortgage, we did a cash flow showing how we were going to pay for that farm, and it was based on raising so much livestock, so many bushels of corn, wheat, soybeans, hay, etc. And as time went on, you know, we did a better job every year. We produced a lot more livestock than we ever said we would. We produced a lot more grain than we ever said we would, I guess more than we even thought we could. But we get after about 10 years of that, we missed a payment to the Federal Land Bank because the price wasn't there. We were doing the job. Probably the year we did the very best job was the year we got the least return on investment on our labor. We're spending all of our time, all of our energy producing these crops and livestock, which we like doing, but when you come up short at the end of the year and your lender says, look, you know, you're not going to farm next year because you haven't made enough money, and here we did the best job we ever did. Something went right, you know. That's not the way it should be. We should have been rewarded for good production and for good work, and we weren't.
Well, I think if anybody thinks the 85 Farm Bill has solved the farm crisis, then they ought to come home to South Carolina with me. There's less than 230 dairy farmers left in the entire state.
It's hurting the family farmer, but it's been the most expensive farm bill that we've ever had. And it's not working. We can see that daily with farmers going out of business. Right now it's the end of the fall season, and you open up your local papers and there's all these farms for sale and all this farm equipment for sale. And so, you know, anybody that can say that that farm bill has been working just hasn't been living out there on the land like we have.
And the South Carolina farmers, just like Minnesota or Wisconsin or Texas or wherever, we all have the right to produce a quality product in our own homes for our own people. And we deserve a fair price for it to make a living. And when you see farmers that's been in business for 20 and 30 years going broke and bellies up, I don't think the 85 Farm Bill solved anything but reducing farmers in America.
Like where I live, there's many small communities. You go around to those small communities nowadays and there isn't anything left. There used to be the little local grocery stores, a little local restaurant. But nowadays, that's all gone. Those windows are all boarded up, and you know they just don't have anything left.
On the other side of it, there's a segment of farmers that has totally been wiped out during this crisis. And black farmers in the U.S., there's only about less than 40,000 black farmers left. There's in the black community that's less than 4 million acres of land, where at one time that was over 15 million acres of land, whereas at one time that was over some 15 years ago, that was over 100,000 black farmers. So there's a crisis there. And I don't see anything right now short of legislation that's going to deal with that.
If you had a decent price for the product, then you would be able to make a decent living. But the bottom line is price.
Well, a black farmer has, if he grows corn, first of all, there's no price. Second of all, if he grows, he can't afford equipment. He cannot afford a $50,000 combiner, and these kinds of things.
A box of corn flakes costs more than a bushel of corn. Now, something is radically wrong there.
We're not greedy. We merely want to live and be able to paint my barn, and I need a new pickup, and I need a new pair of boots and a haircut, and why, with what I produce for this country, why am I not getting that?
In 1973, it took the gross receipts of 15 calves to buy a pickup. Today, it takes the gross receipts of 45 calves. During that same period of time, you could buy a 125 horsepower tractor with the gross receipts from 4,000 bushels of wheat. Today, it takes over 13,000 bushels of wheat to buy that same tractor. Our purchasing power is gone. And when we can't buy, labor can't build, merchants can't sell, and you will see a continual erosion of the labor market and a continual pressure on consumers to pay more and more for their food. There is little correlation between what the consumer pays for in the grocery store and the price of that particular product at our farm gate.
We take the raw product away from the farmer at a ridiculously low price, corn and wheat and milk and chickens, you name it. And yet the consumer's price keeps going up, farmers keep going down.
Between 1980 and 1987, the value to the farmer in the wheat in a box of cereal diminished from 3 cents to 2 cents. We lost 33%. During that same period of time, the company that made that cereal increased its profits by 87%. The consumer suffered and the farmer suffered.
Today, and as we enter a new decade, there are still 20 to 30% of the farmers in this country who are very marginal and are unlikely to survive, and probably even a larger number than that.
Our prices that we received at the farm were up, but not because of the 1985 Farm Bill, because of the droughts. If we have good weather this next year, our prices are going to go down. They're already asking us to plant more because our supply reserves are down.
You know that the crisis is over. It's a myth, you know, because those people who actually profit don't want to see a real family farm bill that would deal with prices and would correct those things that was not done. In fact, that was not really a farm bill. You know, that was a Food Insecurity Act, and it didn't deal with just the bare bone issues of farming, price, the credit systems of farm, and those things that need to be dealt with.
The 85 Farm Bill particularly benefited the large commercial-sized farm operators in this country and major agribusiness corporations, the Cargills and ConAgras and IBPs of this country. And the bill was designed to do that. Most federal farm policy in this country is designed to benefit agribusiness and not the family farmer.
Three companies are in control of over 75% of the meatpacking industry. When they control the packing industry, now they have backed up so that they either own or control much of the feeder industry. When they control the feeder industry, it brings pressure back to us as a cow-calf operator so that there will be no competition for buying our calves.
International merchant has no loyalty. I mean, they use the lip service to the American flag as we're part of you, but they have no loyalty to this country or any other country for that matter. Whether they're in Rotterdam or in Houston or Duluth, Minnesota, matters not where that product come from or where its destination is, just so it moves. So they have no allegiance to our consumers, and they have no allegiance to our nation or our society.
I want to save small family farms. I want to save them for my children. I want to save them for my grandchildren. I want to keep these people on the farm. It's a wonderful way of life. I raised 4 sons on the farm, and they all worked, and they all learned the work ethic and how important it is, and the love for the land. And I'd like for our farmers to be able to continue to do that.
My son just left my farm. Many sons have got smart enough to know that they don't have to work 12 and 14 hours a day, 7 days a week to make less than minimum wages. We're not bringing idiots up today. We're bringing smart young people that says, Dad, I'm sorry, I hate to leave you, but I got to think about myself.
We did a good job and produced a lot of corn, and they said, oh, well, it's not worth anything. There's too much of it. And that's when my husband and I both began to get involved and say, look, this whole farm policy thing is, it's screwy. It's all wrong. It's all backwards. You know, we should have had this farm paid for in less time than we planned instead of getting behind. So that's when we got involved, and it seemed like the coalition and the people that make up the coalition were the only ones that were saying those same kind of things. That, hey, we're working hard, we're doing a good job, but we're not making any money, and we're, you know, we're falling away.
All is not well at all out in the country, and that we have to have a farm bill passed in 1990 that will provide us more income. At the same time, this bill would help provide a safe source of food for consumers. It would farmers would have more money to spend in their local communities. It would help laboring people. It would just help everybody. The rural economy is in really bad shape right now, and so I think that's why it's important, and we have to get out and tell the story, and we can get out and tell the story.
The position of the National Family Farm Coalition and its member organizations across the country has always been that we've had to have a solid price, a solid income level for farmers to survive. That means raising price supports, it means moving toward a supply management system, it means moving toward a sustainable agricultural system that provides good prices to farmers who make the transition, and it means taking every step possible and necessary to protect family farm operators and not to gear public policy toward the large corporations that currently dominate the agricultural scene in this nation.
If the coalition's bill were passed in its entirety, our whole idea is that farmers will get the price they need to cover the cost of production plus some profit that replaces equipment and keeps them going, have a living. Instead, and they will get this from the marketplace. Multinational grain companies will have to pay the fair market value of our commodities instead of being subsidized by the taxpayers. Therefore, that's what our bill will do. They will say, you will be paid on the number of bushels, of pounds of milk, pounds of cotton, whatever, the fair market value and on these commodities. And in order to prohibit or eliminate surpluses, not inventory, just surpluses, we will have a supply management program that says you will produce what's needed by this country, what's needed for exports, what's needed for food pantries. Nobody will go hungry, but we will only produce what we need, and you will be paid the cost of production plus some profit for it.
It would provide an abundant supply of food, a stable supply of quality food at affordable prices. And the way that we have done that is to require that the Secretary of Agriculture determine what the need is for the products. He already does that. And so we're saying, after you've determined what the need for the domestic, for the international trade, for the humanitarian programs, and for a reserve, when that need is established, then tell us as farmers how much we need. How much is needed for those four needs, and we'll produce it.
There are still wheat farmers that believe the more they plant, they're still going to get $5 a bushel, and it's not going to happen. I've also talked to big dairymen who said they'd be glad to milk half the cows they milk if we had a price. Oregon has statewide supply management of milk, and it works, and they have $14 to $16 milk, and they don't pay more for their milk in a store than we do in Idaho.
His financial incentive would be the fact that he produced so many bushels, he's going to get paid for those bushels at the cost of production, and if he can use, he doesn't have to have high production on limited acres, he can have lower production on more acres, and therefore he can even increase his profits greater by reducing the inputs of expensive synthetic chemicals. There's some flexibility built in here, because if I'm supposed to produce 10,000 bushel of corn and I produce 12, then I can only sell at this market price my 10,000, my allotment. But I have a choice. I can store that other 2,000 bushel on my farm at my expense, and next year I only have to raise 8,000 bushel. And that's the other thing this bill does. It allows us to be a part of saving for a disaster, either at our own expense by on-farm storage or by selling to the commodity credit corporation at a very reduced price, so that that's there as a reserve. It's an inventory, something to fall back on. It doesn't have to cost the taxpayers when we do have a drought.
Farmers should get their money from the marketplace. Our bill will allow for that. Farmers should be moving to more sustainable methods of farming with less chemicals. Our bill will account for that. The 85 Farm Bill does not. We in this nation are entitled, I think, as a matter of national security, to a food reserve. We would provide for that in our bill. The 1985 Farm Bill has brought us to dangerously low levels of reserves.
We can't fight with money. We can't fight the money that Monsanto has, or the money that some of the multinational cartels have that put the pressure on our congressmen. So we have to do it with the voting numbers and with that sort of input. And from the grassroots up is how our laws should be made, not from the money down.
The influence has been more and more come from corporate America. Corporate America that can't vote, but it can sure influence. You as a citizen, and myself as a citizen, must not abdicate our authority as citizens to non-voting entities in our country.
How do we get to the consumer? How do we get to the inner city resident? How can we get to the kid who thinks a glass of milk come from the refrigerator or the jug come from the store? How do we get to, you know, the family who thinks the loaf of bread come off the shelf, has no earthly idea about the farming?
It's absolutely critical that once again give voice and shape to a new message of struggle and power and political empowerment in rural America and across the entire country. There has to be a renewal of a democratic and a progressive movement in this country that addresses the fundamental economic and social justice problems of rural people and urban people, of working people of all races and ethnic orientation.
And there's been a crisis in the black farm community for over 50 years, but coming together we find that there's much concern all over the country for the farming issue within the farm community. Before now, farmers, both black and white, have not had a voice on Capitol Hill. This is the only piece of hope that many farmers have in this country. In fact, I believe it's the only hope that this country has, is to let people have a voice.
Well, the best way to communicate with your legislator is either through mail or through calls or through personal contacts. And the best way to do that is usually through a direct contact between you and your congressman or your senator, because that way there is a little bit of leverage there. After all, if somebody from Iowa writes me, even as the chairman of the subcommittee, I'll listen to him, but I'm going to listen probably even more carefully to my constituent in central Kansas, who can vote for me and can exert leverage over me. And so therefore the best way to work is directly by getting to know your congressman or your senator and making sure that they know that you're credible and that you have substantive advice, a bona fide, good faith substantive advice on how to change farm policy. The next best way is to join a farm organization or some other kind of organization which has as its goal modifications or changes in farm programs or rural policy generally. Either approach is fine, but it won't happen if you just sit home. I'm telling you, I know too many people who just sit home and don't like the way things are and think that that's the way it always has to be. It doesn't.
Only the family farmers and the consumers can make a difference. This is the year to do it. This is the year to get involved. If you're going to take 5 minutes of your time and call your congressman, this is the year, not next year, that we need to do it. Not after our prices are slashed and not after the farm bill's written, but right now.
We can make the changes. It has to come from the grassroots. It can't come from Washington.
The folks out in the country are the experts. We're really the managers that are trying to implement what the experts know about. And what I have found after nearly 14 years in Congress is that as a general proposition, if you listen to the wisdom of people who've done this job for years and years and years, you'll ultimately end up doing the right thing And if we don't listen to the folks at home, that's when we screw up.
You can make a phone call, or you can write a letter, or you can get somebody else to write a letter. And you can actually affect farm policy. That's what is important to me, that I can make a difference.
Debate on the 1990 Farm Bill is now taking place in Washington, D.C. We need your help to win passage of the Family Farm Act. How? Join your local grassroots organization in support of the Family Farm Act. Write your senators and congressmen. Send a tax-deductible contribution to help in this important effort. Send it to National Family Farm Coalition, 80 F Street Northwest, Suite 714, Washington, D.C., 20001. Remember, laws should be made from the grassroots up, not from the money down.